I'm Dr. Shashikala Gurkul. I'm the director of Symbiosis Law School since 2007. Prior to joining Symbiosis Law School, I've been predominantly a law teacher, but I have also had a couple of years of stint in corporate sector and another 2 years in non-governmental sector. To put briefly the essence of my experience, basically, I was a National Merit Scholarship holder and I moved to science like how other students do. But when I was doing science, I had certain family circumstances where we had lot of wealth through land, but that wealth was arrested or mired in disputes. So somebody had to take initiative to understand and resolve these legal disputes which were pending for 4-5 generations. So I left science, which was my passion. Joined the law school, tried to understand, got good network in student politics, etc., and solved all those disputes out of court before I could get the law degree. Thereafter, I moved to do my master's because there was no other mission. The mission was achieved. So I went ahead with the master's, and during the master's program in Mysore, specializing in international law, I came under the influence of great social activists and thinkers, because Mysore campus, as you would know, is a very liberal campus. And it is there Gandhian, Buddhist thinkers, Dalit activists, feminists. So that molded my approach, and I realized that my deeper calling was justice. So legal education is only a means to that deeper calling. And legal education is not a limitation, but an opportunity to look at all the stakeholders in the system of justice. So I have entered legal education not just for getting a job or making a livelihood, but to make a difference to the seekers of justice. So by 91, I started my career in Mangalore. Before I could get my degree, I was offered a job in the college that I graduated from. But I kept my engagement with the people's movement. It was literacy movement, women's liberation movement, Dalit activism, tribal rights issues. So I was reckoned as the foremost intellectual in the field of justice and rights in coastal Karnataka. After about 4 years, I got the opportunity, rather offer, from Bangalore National Law School. It was just beginning then. So Dr. Madhav Menon, the founder of the law school, visited our law school and offered me the assistant professor position. So I was the first woman to procure a tenured lecturer position in National Law School. But within 1 year, I met this law professor from Ireland, and I had to move out, marrying him. So my stint in the international education started with my teaching position in National University of Ireland, Cork. But because my maternity was also parallelly running, I was doing teaching and I was engaged with community education there also. Our primary focus was enlightening women on their rights and human rights issues in the context of development, which Ireland was also going through as a post-colonial society. From there, when my son was about 2 years, I moved back to my hometown in Mangalore. I continued my engagement with the rights movement, feminist NGOs, tribal issues. So between 98 and 2002, I was teaching in a media institute, law and ethics, media studies, cultural studies, and quite active. I created a forum, a newsletter on women's rights in the Kannada language, which has about 30,000 circulation now. And the movement has continued with two other NGOs emulating the example of gender and human rights core focus. So this has been the time of Manipal. And from Manipal, I moved to Middle East because I got a corporate job. There was a need because of some personal crisis of my mother's sudden death. So I had to move to Middle East for 2 years as a break. Now that corporate job gave me the understanding of where the global workforce is moving, how international workplaces are to be structured, how from being an activist and a teacher, one could become a productive leader in a corporate setup. So that orientation of the Middle East also gave me a lot of insights about the Western Asia and the multicultural community, working community. And then I got the Symbiosis offer. By 2007, I moved here. This is briefly the way in which I have gone career-wise. But personally, the deeper impact in my life has been of capacity and power of law. I always tell my students, law can paralyze even a mighty elephant, because that's the power that law has, because law is the only discipline which defines rights, and it defines strategies to protect rights, strategies to resist violations of rights, and it is a means to justice, because ultimately justice is harmony, it's equilibrium. Justice is about a situation where peace and human development are automatically achieved. So by the time I came to liberalized, globalized India by about 2001, I realized that in India, human development focused understanding of law was very much not there. One was that Indian law schools are very focused on what and how of law. How to work with law, how to create good professionals, how to groom them as people fit for multiple careers, where you can find it, and what to do with it. These were the concerns. Why law works in such cases, and in some cases law doesn't work. This kind of critical understanding of law was very, very much limited to certain leading law schools, or Delhi Law School, or JNU. So I was thinking that I should get a platform where the best practices of whatever I have learned from the West and other places can be replicated. Governance of the law school could also be put on the basis of rule of law. And working of the law school in terms of its participants, who are faculty, students and the community, need not be independent of the justice system. If you look at the medical education, for example, medical education works in such a way that practitioners are teaching and they practice as well. Whereas in legal education, unfortunately, we don't have that kind of flexibility in India. Whereas in the West, it is there. Somebody can be an adjunct faculty and also can practice. In India, such flexibility, we have been experimenting here with our faculty. And also that professionalism, if you want to create in students, professionalism can come to place where you create that deep sense of public service, using your knowledge in service of society, in service of the nation. Now that sense, irrespective of whether you are a rich law school or poor law school, private law school or public law school, that commitment has to be generated. So, you know, I did deeper study of quality legal education in the American context, in the Indian context, the famous McBride report. McBride report was way back in the 70s. India had a number of declarations and conferences of law people, people like Bakshi, people like Menon, talking about quality legal education. So I studied all these models, and by the time I joined Zimbabwe's law school, by 2008, the famous Carnegie report was out in the US. Carnegie report summarized only one line, that how can we make legal profession more ethical and more professional on the lines of medical profession. So that report inspired me a lot to review and revisit how I had learned, how I had taught, how some of the good law schools where I worked taught, and then create a model which could work as a model to be reckoned with. So in symbiosis, I got that opportunity. I thank the university, Dr. Mazumdar, Dr. Vidya and the whole team who gave that liberty, and the young team of faculty and the vibrant student community which worked with me to develop such a model. So today we have that kind of a model in symbiosis law school, which I could explain later. So this is my story, my journey. A journey in the path of justice, knowledge and justice, leading to a kind of institutionalized working of a model on quality legal education, which combines the rationalism of the West with the compassion of the East. So that is the kind of model that we are doing with the pragmatism of corporate approach, with the idealism of professional and ethical approach. So this is how we are experimenting here. Now, one of the things that was a natural fallout was that I was nominated on the Law Commission of India in 2010 because my work in Karnataka and later the work through the law school was recognized through the stakeholders. So within 6 months of nomination on the Law Commission, I was also nominated for a very prestigious award called Legal Education Innovation Award, because of the way in which the benchmarks of quality legal education was incorporated in our work. Then also some of the writings and some of the speeches which inspired lot of women who were women who required assistance, women who were in the movement, who were in the field, also was recognized as in terms of awards within Maharashtra as well. So this is the path that I have traveled, the path of excellence in legal education and the path of commitment to justice. Symbiosis Law School Pune is located in the strong trait of advocacy. People say that Symbiosis' strongest DNA is internationalism. I don't deny that, but I say that its stronger DNA is advocacy. What is advocacy? Advocacy is standing up for the voiceless. It is giving. It is representing the one who can't speak for oneself. If you look at the history of Symbiosis, it was created way back in 1971 to give voice to those After Asian students who were cornered or marginalized in the then landscape of Pune. Now, these students came from countries which were either opening up to modern civilization or from countries which were mired in colonialism. So, the such students did not necessarily have the rich context of Pune students or the social support which students deserve or require at the tender age. So Dr. Mazumdar opened his home in 1971, his resources, his ideas, in such a way that these students were treated equally, these were enabled. So English language teaching was one of those efforts which got institutionalized. But if you look at the law school, the evolution of the law school was in such a landscape of Pune, where there was only one law school before that, existing for nearly 50 years. So Pune, Symbiosis Law School Pune was the second law school to be created. It was initially created to cater to those who did not have the opportunity of getting a legal education after their hard working hours, long, hard and long working hours in various jobs in Pune, because Pune being the headquarters of army had large majority of people working in the army, or a certain higher percentage was also in the automobile industry. Now, in 1977, one could open the law school only as an affiliate to a state university. So, our law school has the history in a very strongly rooted Pune University's affiliation. From 1977 to 2002, in such affiliated existence also, it had important landmarks. For example, it was the first law school to offer the five-year law program among the four or five other law schools in the country. Because by then the Indian legal education thinkers felt that our legal education was getting diluted as a part-time legal education, where the graduates or employed people would come for a part-time course. Teachers would not teach with the seriousness. So standards of legal education started improving with this language. So by about 1985, five-year law course was introduced. Because Symbiosis Law School was advised by Advocate Ram Jaikumalani, who is a legal legend in the country, who was a close friend of Dr. Mazumdar, who was then heading the Bar Council of India, which is the regulatory body for legal education, we got these new ideas implemented within no time. So that way this law school has been very, very fortunate. So by 1985, that important milestone was created. In the 90s, it was a saga of success, because by about 2000, when the national ranking system was introduced for the first time by India Today, Symbiosis Law School was already figuring as one of the top three law schools in the country. The reason for that is also that by about 2000, we had our very competent management institutes created. So some of the best practices were traveling from the field of management to the field of legal education. We had our technology institute, computer science institute created. Those ideas were also coming in the IT governance of legal education, etc. So this law school was experiencing a lot of these innovative practices, which was not there, even though national law schools were created by about 1991, the first law school was created in Bangalore. It was a standalone law school. For it, such best practices could not so easily percolate. Second was that the other law colleges were affiliated to the university. We were also affiliated, but we were in the company of these autonomous management schools. So for us, that strength was something to be emulated. So in an informal way, we used to run combined programs of law and management as diplomas, etc. So that rubbed on our teaching faculty and students. So I'm giving this background for you to appreciate what is unique to symbiosis. Everybody says in Pune also, we are also a private law school. We also have a beautiful infrastructure. We too have good faculty. We too have more than 20 years of experience. But what is there in symbiosis? Why it should be so important? Why there are so many people applying for symbiosis? Now the reason is very clear. We have had an existence much longer than our autonomous existence. So we have discipline inculcated in us being part of an affiliated university. Secondly, receiving openness to receive the best practices from everywhere, to innovate, whether it is 5-year law program. Later by 2005, we introduced another innovation, the first ever undergraduate program combining business administration and law. Now, this was done by Jodhpur National Law School and us. We were the only two in the whole country to do that. By about 2000, Hyderabad National Law School was created. By 2005, Jodhpur was created. But still, Symbiosis Law School kept rubbing its shoulders with these leading law schools in terms of best practices. Now, by 2005, our first batch was being developed, because 2002 we became the deemed university, as you know. Government of India conferred the deemed university status based on excellence on very few selected institutions. So we brought together Symbiosis Institute of Business Management, which is a flagship institute, the Law College, and then Symbiosis Institute of Computer Science. So these three were conjointly called as Symbiosis International University. So only three faculties existed in the early stages, and this was one of those institutes and faculties. But between 2002 and 2007, our first batch was being educated, and in that first batch we had given the BBA LLB option. So by 2007, when I took over a very rich legacy which had existed in quality legal education. Now my job was to develop it further. So developing it further was inspired by the Carnegie report criteria, benchmarking of McBride report, and I started comparing the benchmarks of quality that was in-house with the benchmarks of quality across the country and across the world. And I saw that there was still scope for development. And one such initiative was upgrading our honors program. I mean, upgrading our undergraduate program into honors program. So we have now BA LLB, BBA LLB honors program. Only national law schools offer honors program now, whereas we offer an honors program. Second initiative was, by about 2012, UGC introduced the possibility of 1-year LLM, because a lot of students travel abroad to do this 1-year LLM program. In India, generally, LLM program is 2 years. And wherever LLM program is offered, very limited specializations were offered, either constitutional law or criminal law or a combination of the two or corporate law. So we created the cafeteria approach in LLM, where students could create their cafeteria or a menu of courses. So this was an innovation. The third one was, law is the least internationalizable discipline. You know why? Law is bound up with governance. Law is bound up with territoriality. Whereas our law school, among our sister institutes, was receiving the most influx of international faculty, international visiting students, and demand from all over the world to affiliate. For example, Harvard has identified us as one of the institutes to spend the summer program with. We have not received directly Harvard students, but students who are affiliated to some of the institutes with which Harvard has collaboration is visited. For example, we had a student from the Idaho University. We have students from City University of New York spending either a semester or 6 weeks or a month. So in internationalization, we developed very strong footprint. By 2005, European Commission gave a huge grant to a few universities across the world to come together and form something called Global Legal Consortium, which is a very innovative practice. In that, they had law schools from Brazil, law school from Portugal, law school from Thailand, law school from China, then one law school from Germany, and two law schools from France. Now, they were looking for partners in India. I'm very happy to say that we were identified as the partner. So, we are the only Indian law school which is partner with this global consortium, which means The LLM which is offered by this consortium has the option for the students to do some courses or semesters in any of these universities. So, our students did not opt for that LLM, but because they were exposed to these students, they could apply for other Erasmus grants. So, I have had students developing expertise in Spanish or developing expertise in German or French, going and doing their degrees and getting such high kind of high level careers. I mean, one of them has been now working in Mumbai in one of the leading shipping law practitioner firms. Another student is teaching in a leading law school, which is global law school. So all these were possible because of the Erasmus Mundus participation. So we were identified in 2005. Now 10 years down the line, we still continue with that partnership. Students come here, spend a semester, take the credits are identified as part of the LLM degree that this consortium confers on the students. So internationalization was that dimension. Then we had the dimension of the gap which I found where we could develop further was professional development. Now, the university to which we were affiliated hitherto, and the way we continued that legacy was something that we as a team critically rethought. That was how you teach the practical dimension of law, application dimension. For example, you may be shadowing with a lawyer, you may be apprenticing with a lawyer, you may be clerking with a judge. So, how do you train them? How do you see the list of competencies that lawyers have and the competencies that are taught or learnt by the students, and how do you correlate with the classroom learning? You know, it was told by Narayan Murthy, the founder of Infosys in Harvard, that business is not taught in business school. So lawyers also have a feeling that lawyering is not taught in law school. So our primary focus was, how do we create an outcome in terms of a finished product of a student who has least gap in training in terms of exiting the law school and joining the profession. So this is the way in which we had to identify the competencies and develop them in that competency. So we created a structured development plan. Some students may not fit into that plan, so we taught students how to think in terms of plan A, plan B, identifying their, benchmarking their existing strengths, developing, identifying their interests and opportunities and developing their plan A, plan B. So this was in terms of outcome of student development. Then we looked at faculty development. How do you develop faculty? How do you train them? How do you identify them to have what we call as a proper teacher profile? What kind of a teacher is this teacher? Is she or he an expert? Is she or he a generalist? Is she or he having number of skill sets? Is she an ardent researcher? So how do we develop? Even our recruitment processes we had to reform from that point of view. Then, the teaching learning to be substituted and supplemented and strengthened by involving judges and lawyers. So, we spotted some of the very academic judicial members. We spotted some of the experts across the country. We strengthened our alumni network. We used them to participate in the college. We used them as our ambassadors, goodwill ambassadors, to bring better knowledge resources to the college. And our alumni who had been abroad also became our outside ambassadors and brought more contacts of professors, knowledge and opportunities for our students. So an all-round unleashing of the huge potential of this college happened between 2007 and 2012. And the output is very clear that the ranking of the law school always got maintained at top 4, top 5 positions. Now, another important outcome that we created was strengthening the research. We started an in-house journal, and this journal was contributed to by a number of eminent people on the editorial, and students from all over India, faculty from all over India, researchers from all over India started contributing. Some of the international experts also came. So we started creating a conference which fed into this journal. So there was a feeder conference which was conceptualized. And then the journal was co-published by LexisNexis, one of the leading publisher houses in law. So, and I can't list out all the practices. We sent a state community legal service, legal aid. As I told you, that was our primary goal, efficiency, wedding the ethics. So, by 2008, we had generous donation by our foundation, then Advocate Ram Jaikmalani, then some other donors, and we created a corpus fund for community legal service. Now, community legal service was conceptualized in the lines of City University of New York model, because one of the eminent lawyers and professor there, Ted Rooney, came here and spent one semester here. During that period, he developed his model, we can say that we aligned our model with the model which had successfully worked in City University of New York, which is considered as the best model in clinical and legal ethics. So, and we became members of Global Network, Asian Network. We were recognized as one of the most credible law schools in the country, where professors who come here will be given a very structured work plan, the outcome was clear, the professors became transformed, students became transformed. We had students visiting us for 1 month, later coming back to do master's years, rejecting possibilities in US and UK, coming to our law school to pursue their master's. So, eventually, we transformed our infrastructure also. We were in a very small infrastructure. We transformed, we acquired current beautiful infrastructure, which is not only aesthetically good, but also, if you see, scientifically aligned to the benchmarks of quality legal education. So students got a very new kind of model where the best in idea matched with the best in reality. So this is how I would describe this law school. My students and our alumni and our faculty will vouch for it in terms of summarizing it as a transformative educational experience. That is the summary that I would like to give in terms of why this law school is being and how it is being. One or two evidences I can quote. In 2007, for our 200 seats, we used to receive about 1,700 applications. By 2009, we created our own law entrance. Today in the country, if you look at national law school, we have about 14 national law schools. For 14 national law schools, this year around 45,000 applications have been. And the test is called CLAT, you know, Common Law Education. By 2009, I was studying their model. We had a common entrance test for symbiosis undergraduate program called SET, which is called symbiosis entrance. So we debated the idea, myself and Dr. Lee, why not create a separate entrance test for law, which could be benchmarked in the country as a competitor or maybe an alternate version of CLAT. We were different. One difference was that we had similar knowledge. Second difference was that we created logical questions which were not numerical but verbal. So our entrance test, created in 2009, received about 3,000 applications. So mind you, in 2 years, we had almost doubled our registration. Today, our entrance test is reckoned as almost as good as CLAT. Some say that it's better than CLAT, more scientific than CLAT. And today we receive 20,000 applications for those 2 years. So this is an indicator that the experiment which is going on here is very unique and it is reaching the target very effectively. The other indicator is number of students who have been successfully getting admission to Harvard, getting admission to Oxford, Cambridge on scholarship, finishing it and coming back as thought leaders, as partners. Almost 3 weeks ago, there was a report published by Legally India. It's a web-based periodical which reviews legal education and legal profession. It published a survey where it said that across the country, in law firm leadership, we have outsmarted Bangalore National Law School. In fact, in corporate law jobs, Bangalore National Law School has been a front runner since 1995. So we became organized and in autonomous and experimental way like Bangalore Law School only in 2002. But between 2002 and now, we have ousted one of the key players. So that shows that we are very pragmatic and we are producing very competitive lawyers. So this is why this law school is unique. Training judges is one aspect which is part of continuing legal or judicial education. In India, the need for judicial education was identified from the beginning, but it got institutionalized at the national level only in the early part of this millennium, by about 2003, when the National Judicial Academy was created. However, state judicial academies were in functioning. They insisted more on language modules and things like that in the language, regional language, and then a little more on national judicial development. I should say that this whole event of training judges today was motivated by three factors. It was strengthened by three aspects. The main motivation was that our American friend, Judge Christy Leah Harrington from the South Carolina, was here as a Fulbright scholar. We thought that two aspects of American judicial practice, the strongest aspect, were slightly lesser in India. One was respect for the rule of law, where courts as well as the citizens have to play a key role, and the implementation of that rule of law, compliance with the rule of law, is very strong in the US, as much as in the European countries. I was telling in the morning, they may not be as high as Scandinavian countries, yet rule of law and respect for rule of law, and therefore the access to justice and protection of rights, which are reckoned as one of the facets of human development index under the Makbul Hussein report, are very important in a democratic country like India, where it is still evolving, it is not that strong. To strengthen that, we have to have all stakeholders of justice coming together. So, Judge Christie coming from US has a training in that, experience in that of more than 9 years. And she has been a judge who is selected going through a different kind of process where not only the judiciary but also members of the public vote for selection of the judge. We thought that it would be very interesting for our judges to understand that. Second is the kind of implementation of training, best practices which they follow, which result in very high degree of conviction rate. For example, if 100 cases come before the court to be criminal cases, only in 17 to 18%, now the national average is 21% cases, the offender gets punished in India. Whereas in the US, that rate is 80%. So we thought that this is the second reason why Judge Christie should share her process of judging, because she came from the background of criminal law and being overseeing the prosecutor's office as well. And the way the prosecutor's office works in the US system and the way it works in India also are interesting contrasts. So we thought that an authentic voice like Judge Christie could bring these ideas to our judges at Pune level. For the first time at the Pune level, such a training is happening. It was our ambitious project because way back in 2008, we thought of calling a judges conference. We could not succeed because judges have their own protocols. They cannot come to a private law school. They cannot come unless the High Court gives the permission. High Court will have reservation in giving the permission unless it is run by High Court collaborating national law schools or other judicial academies. So, being situated in Pune and judicial academy being in Uttan, it was not practical either. So, from 2008, our build-up started. First, we forged our relationship with the Maharashtra Judicial Academy, where because of our relationship with Justice Chandrachud, who then was the Maharashtra High Court Judge, Mumbai High Court Judge, who was also on our board of trustees, who gave us the opportunity to have a collaborative judgment writing training for our students. So this is how our relationship with the judicial training began. By 2010, my engagement with the National Judicial Academy started. I was invited as a speaker on looking at how law schools and judges could collaborate in guaranteeing and delivering the constitutional promises. So that participation at the workshop showed how relationship between law schools and judges is either hierarchical or it is symbiotic. And this hierarchical relationship further got manifested in the control of national law schools by judges as chancellors, etc. Whereas the symbiotic relationships were very few. So by that time we had one instance of us participating with the local judiciary, where we helped the local judiciary to sift through number of cases of juvenile delinquencies, whereby we got 6 wrongly listed juveniles as delisted. So this success of our collaboration leading to contribution to justice system in the country gave us the confidence that let us train our students, let us get into hardcore judicial training. So I was invited by Justice Shalini Pansalkar Joshi, who then was the director of Judicial Academy Maharashtra, to deliver a module on gender justice. So there, during the course, they realized that we had lots of resources to share. So my other junior faculties were also invited for a couple of sessions. But our relationship with training students with the Judicial Academy is continuing every year. Our second year or third year students go there for a 2-day module on testing and judgment writing. Now I am on the Academic Council of National Judicial Academy. So one of the suggestions I gave to the Judicial Academy was understanding best practices in India. The inspiration for this idea came to me from my experience as a member of the Law Commission when I had visited 3 courts. One was Mumbai High Court, the other was Bangalore, Karnataka High Court, the third was Chennai High Court. And I had made certain questionnaires. These questionnaires were developed based on my acquaintance with the Delhi High Court, because today if you assess any High Court in terms of backlog clearance, in terms of expertise being considered in allocation of judicial work, in managing seniority, in administrative responsibility, with my limited understanding, I could safely say that Delhi High Court has a host of best practices. So I prepared a questionnaire based on their best practices, and I tried to compare those factors in those 3 high courts which I visited, and I found to my dismay that all the best practices were not present in any high court fully. Mumbai High Court was very good in terms of creating additional court schedules, you know, the evening court to relieve the backlog. Bangalore High Court was very good in preparing manuals for referring to ADR. Chennai High Court was very good in normal practices, but nobody has had the number of innovative approaches which Delhi High Court had. So, in this meeting in National Judicial Academy with the High Court judges, I shared this experience of mine, and then I also shared what the Chief Justice said, that credibility of the judiciary is endangered today. Particularly, he had given certain examples. So, based on that statement, I started showing the contrast between the performance of the Gujarat Mufassil Court or District Court and the Maharashtra Court and Karnataka Court. For example, today's backlog, if it has to be relieved in the court, at the rate of disposal that courts are doing, Gujarat will take at least 39 years, for which Maharashtra will take 1 year or Karnataka will take 1 year. Now, such a contrast is there, which means we need to catch judges who are working at the Mufassil level and try to understand their problems. Given their protocols, we thought the best opportunity to do this was when Judge Christie is here. So how American courts have battled with such challenges, how American judges have overcome such challenges could be an inspiration and could be a beginning point to engage in such debate and to make our judiciary more people-friendly, more efficient, more conscientious, more ethical. And also, in terms of better use of technology, better interaction, better learning practices. So, we also thought that judges normally do not get the opportunity to learn in the local law school. Relationship between judges and law schools are still not very symbiotic. Judges' experiential sharing with our young students has not been happening. We have got, for example, in our training today, about 50 judges. These 50 judges are a very big minefield of information and experience. What we teach from the books as academics could be really enriched and made more authentic and meaningful to our young students if these judges bring their experiential learning to the classroom. So through this training and engagement, we wanted to give them a feel of getting back to school, getting back to law school. And thereby, we expect that it will trigger their engagement in the law school. We also thought that the mystifying environment of the court could be simplified and made more accessible to youngsters like our students and also to the teachers if the bridge was built between the court and the law school. Because each law school is having the potential of creating so many judges for the future. Those future judges should think that court system is here to serve democracy. It is here to protect constitution. It is to ensure justice. So it cannot be still mired in the pre-colonial or the colonial days obscurity, you know. So the colonial psyche which is there, it needs to be unlearned. The post-colonial confusions which are there, they need to be cleared. So we hope that with this training, we make such a micro attempt in Pune. It is believed that what happens in Pune happens in India today, happens in India tomorrow. Pune has always been a kind of place where transformative ideas have evolved in the independence struggle or later on also in nation building. So we hope that this idea will cascade itself across the country, and a lot of eminent people who visit this country on different occasions, especially from legal stakeholders of legal system, this experiment will get strengthened and replicated across the country. That's the hope.